And welcome to this week's edition of Twin Peaks Unwrapped. I'm your host, Brian Kazoskin. Beside me is...
Ben Durant.
Hello, Ben.
Hey, Brian. How are you?
Good, good. Long time no see.
Oh, yeah. I saw you last week. I see you at least every week. We probably talk every day.
I know. But, you know, in radio and podcast land, we have to have the mystery. Like, we don't talk right. at all until we actually sit down in front of the mics, and then
though,
we just talk.
I think it's been a half hour we've been talking now.
I know.
All right, so this is Twin Peaks Unwrapped. We're on episode number 21.
Yes.
And this episode is written by Scott Frost.
Which, is that Mark Frost's brother?
That's correct.
Didn't read that off your notes. I was actually a genuine question, and yes. I just saw that.
And he actually did do, I mean, I don't know if he's ever credited for this, but we've mentioned before, he actually did write all the stuff for the Dale Cooper tapes, you know, those audio tape messages. He did all the writing for that. And
so... Scott Frost has been part of this process probably since the beginning of somehow.
A little
some
bit.
Way.
I mean, like he. I mean, he also wrote. I think he also wrote the episode between Maddie's death and catching the death of Leland. So I think he did that middle episode where the audience knows Leland is the murderer, but Cooper doesn't know. I think he did that one. So he's
I mean, like, it's so hard. Everyone. A lot of people, I'm not going to say everybody, but a lot of people have warned me, oh, this, you know, including yourself about these episodes. But here we have Scott Frost, who has been, seems to be, probably Mark has, is in his ear, I'm sure, or he knows what's going on. He's been here kind of since the beginning, if some capacity. So he knows how the story should move along a little bit.
Yes, and the other thing, I mean... We don't do everything in order. There's also a book, a tie-in book, just like there was the Laura Palmer book.
Yeah.
There is the book called Autobiography of FBI Agent Dale Cooper.
Which we haven't read or talked about.
Yes. I purposely wanted to wait till after the series and before Firewalk With Me to do that book.
I'm excited for that.
Yeah, I feel like it's a good tie-in. Actually, I feel like it kind of deals with what's happening now in the show. And I feel like in the way the show ends and what was in the script and what we didn't see, I think it would be a good tie-in till after the series. So he was writing this, and I think it came out in January. So we're now in it's February 2nd, 1991 is this episode, and I think the book came out in January. So just to give you a sense. So he was working on the book while everybody else was working on the show.
So
he's got he has a good sense of Twin Peaks.
And you know what? This half, you know, honestly, to me, this half of the show has become the mythology of Agent Cooper.
Yeah, I like that. The backstory,
it's
right?
It's a backstory of Agent Cooper. Really is. And I think that's what makes it fun.
Yeah, I agree.
I don't think these are as bad as they were built up in my head.
Yeah.
I mean, there are bad elements. I do agree there are bad subplots, definitely.
I think bad use
of characters. Yeah. But all in all... I'm having fun watching it.
Awesome.
Yeah, I'm having fun. But sometimes it is cringeworthy, but
right.
I don't know.
I think about the backstory. It was like in the first season, you know, the whole time where Audrey is in Cooper's bed in his room and stuff.
Yeah.
And she says, "Do you have any secrets?" And he says, "No, I don't have any secrets," or something like that. And like we're now starting to realize, oh, he does have some secrets, or he has things that he hasn't wanted to share, and he does have a backstory,
yeah.
And he's not perfect. I mean, we'll get into this episode,
yep.
But we realize he's not as the perfect Eagle Scout as we thought he was. He's got some flaws, which is great. I think that's a great character to have flaws.
It makes him human.
So this is February 2nd, 1991. I want to give you some background on this time period. First, I want to say that, you know, during Christmas period, the show was off for 4 weeks. It was off from, like, basically, it was December 15th was a show, and then it didn't come back to January 12th.
Wow.
So, I mean, that's a long time for a show like this to not be on the air. And,
yeah.
You know, usually what shows can do is they can just say, oh, we'll do a repeat during this period. But you can't do that with this kind of a show because it's a serial and you're waiting to – it's a continuation stuff.
Yeah.
So I think – I mean, the writers would complain about this to say, hey, we were off for a long period of time. And then the week before this episode we're talking about now, which is January 26th, the show was off on hiatus – or it was off because of the Gulf War, the first Iraq War. And that happened a few times where Iraq coverage happened and Twin Peaks wouldn't air. And
that was big back then. I remember
CNN
that.
CNN was the one that really had the coverage of it. And so maybe even people might even want to watch the show even because of that. They might go to CNN and see what's going on with the war and stuff. So I think it was frustrating too. I remember being frustrated where I turn on the TV ready to watch Twin Peaks and I realize, oh, it's not going to air today because of the war and stuff. And being 15, 16 years old, I was like, what?
I know. Put the war on a different channel.
Yeah.
Cancel the war.
So, I mean, that's just give you some background on where we are right now. That they haven't been on for a while. They weren't on last week, and we're gonna find out that they're gonna have some other problems in the near future as well. We'll talk about. So this is directed by Ulla Adel. I already said that it was February 2nd, 1991. The rating is 8.7, and it's 83rd place there for the week. And I think it's not like – I remember sometimes thinking, oh, that's out of 100 shows, but there might only be like 95 shows.
We don't know, yeah.
I was reading some articles, and it was less than 100 shows that were on. So,
and back then, we didn't have a lot of channels back in the day.
Right. Especially if you're thinking network. I mean, I was listening to Mark Frost do an interview, and he was saying – you know, and I think we'll play that at the end, but he was saying – how Fox wasn't even really considered a network. It was sort of was.
Just
it was,
came out.
It was just coming out. I was thinking about that. Like, I don't even know if they had a full schedule. It was one of those things where they had some shows, but I don't know if they had like a full lineup really.
Yeah, I think Fox came out in 89-ish.
Yeah, I mean, we're 92.
So Fox had some shows.
I mean, Simpsons, of course.
Simpsons, but, Married with Children, probably the biggest hitters they had.
Yeah,
you know.
So let's get right into the show. And where we last left off was Cooper and Truman were there was a blackout, and they were in the sheriff's station. And when Cooper went into Harry's office, there was a dead body.
Yeah.
And I mentioned last week that dead body actually is in real life Kyle MacLachlan's brother,
which is cool.
Yeah,
and he looks like him.
It does look like him and stuff. And you wonder sometimes, like, did they do that partly because Cooper? I mean, like. You know, Wyndham Earl would want somebody that would look like Dale Cooper,
yeah,
though. Like,
that's
maybe
a good
he's
point.
Going after him, or
it makes sense to use him because that close up in this whole scene, it does look like Dale Cooper in that chair.
Yeah,
he's got the same mouth and everything.
Right,
so that is interesting. That's a little, you know, I wouldn't notice that if you didn't tell me.
Yeah,
so it's kind of cool.
And I love the touch of having the pawn in the mouth and stuff at that.
Yes, the
kind of reminds me of like the idea of the letters in the fingernails. Like you're hiding things in the body in some ways. You had Laura Palmer's letters in there, and so you had to, you know.
That's what this is happening. Like I was saying before, this half of the show is just taking the nuances that everybody liked in the beginning, and they're redoing it in a different way. So instead of letters, it's chest.
Yeah.
There's more.
But it's like still like the villain is still has these clues kind of leading you to.
So they're taking everything you really liked, and they're reusing it in a different way.
Right.
I almost feel. Instead of a dream, it's like a chess. It's chess pieces.
Yeah.
And like
it's a whole new game.
And the way that guy's dead, he's pointing, it's clues in his mouth, like he's the dream maybe, I don't know. It's
sounds good to me.
It's very interesting though.
So do we want to bring up some audio here?
Sure.
Running short distance before collapsing. Wyndham Earl engineered the explosion that caused the power outage. He created the diversionary fire that drew everyone out of the station, brought the body in through this window. Wyndham Earl has been in this room. I can still feel his presence.
Yeah, so that was kind of cool.
I love that whole thing of I can feel his presence.
Yeah, like
it's like, you know, I think of Star Wars and like Obi-Wan says, and Darth Vader's like, I can sense that.
Yeah, I can feel his. Yeah, exactly. And this is sort of like the dream sequence in a way. It's sort of like it's giving you the layout of everything. And now you got to figure it out. But it's also interesting how Agent Cooper picks it up. Like, he picked up the tracks to the cars.
Yeah.
Instantly. This, he put the fire, the outage, everything. He knew right away. Like, where, you know, they're connecting the dots were just, like, instant.
Right.
So this comes down to the whole Audrey Horne and Bobby
relationship that they've got.
And their little plan.
And we've talked about this, I think, last week, where I was kind of like, is this a love interest? And you're trying to say to me, oh, no, Audrey is just playing with him, kind of, yeah, like, to control him.
I don't think she likes him. I don't think she likes him at
all. I guess not. But they were kind of cute. I mean.
Yeah, I think he likes her. I think because, you know what?
Who wouldn't like her?
Yeah, who wouldn't like her? It's Audrey Horne. But I think he likes her because, well, her father is going crazy. Yep. And hence, you know, she could take over.
Yeah.
And I think he likes that power, the money, and he wants a job with them anyway. And she could be the in for the job. And he gets a different kind of job.
From now on, Bobby, I'm the one you suck up to.
What about Shelly?
What about
Shelly? See? Like,
yeah.
So
what I love about that is, like, she just wants the control. But I love that he says, what about Shelly? And then it cuts right away to Shelly in the house. You know, Leo and Shelly's house.
Now, this is where the show gets a little wonky for me.
Really? Wonky, huh?
It gets a little wonky. The last scene we saw, Leo had clown makeup food face.
Oh, yeah.
Looking at her. But now, all of a sudden, we're back, and now it's dark. He's in the shadow. Shelly's hiding.
I thought it was pretty intense. I mean, it's...
This felt like a horror movie.
Right.
I felt like this felt like the most horror movie... Yeah. Ever this show has ever had.
Yeah.
Other than Leland, the whole Leland stuff. But this was very like Scream,
Like, like the girls in it. What I love what they do with this, I mean, it doesn't matter if we go ahead, that it's like, I love shows that will like, it comes off as Shelly is a damsel in distress. Bobby comes home and then gets himself beat up, and it's Shelly who actually is able to fight off Leo by stabbing him. But I love that, that like she isn't a victim. I mean, and she came off a victim. You think about the first season, that the whole sock and bar soap, and she is kind of like, you know, beat up by her husband and stuff.
Yeah.
And have, you know, this turnaround where, you know, she's going to fight off Leo.
So this is where it's wonky. She's inside a house. How many doors do you know are going to lock you in the house?
Right.
None of the doors. This is where logic escapes. I'm like watching this going, she can unlock the door because it locks from the inside.
You didn't realize that Leo's been planning this for months. Actually, not for months, because it's only probably been a week since he's been in a coma.
Leo just woke up from a coma. He didn't know anything.
He was never really in a coma. Like, when nobody was around, he's like, I'm going to fix these doors.
It made no sense, right?
And I love that he's got the sock, too. Like, he's still in this, like, silhouette, like, in the dark, and you see, like, he just throws a sock at her. But it's, like, classic kind of, like, I'm going to, you know, beat you up.
Yup. And or he's giving it to her, like, use it on yourself. And then she goes to go in the back, and that's locked, too.
Right.
Now, I didn't know this. The plastic was a plastic wall that led to outside.
Oh yeah.
So she could have went out there the whole time, and
she only had enough room to scream though.
Yeah.
But I love the plastic because it still makes me think of Wrapped in Plastic, which we talked about in the first season.
But. Yep. But I like the fact that she does go for it, which this whole time nobody's fixed that wall.
And he throws her with one arm, and he just like tosses her.
I thought it was Nadine dressed up as a guy for a second there, because that's something Nadine would do.
It's so funny. Bobby's kind of been missing. He's been kind of hanging out with Audrey, and then he finally comes back, and it's like...
And now clearly you see there's nothing in front of that door, so it's locked from the inside. Shelly just doesn't know how to use a door in this scene.
Aw, poor Shelly.
No, and I love Shelly. I think she's awesome.
Now Leo's got the axe, and he's going to... Yeah. It is pretty intense. To me, it was really intense. It was like, oh, yeah, this is what I like about Twin Peaks. It's like,
and he's like Frankenstein.
Yeah.
He reminds me of like a classic horror movie.
Definitely. And I think even like as this show continues, it kind of feels like he's not quite all there. And he is
now,
like,
that's where it got wonky, too. It showed Bobby outside. A hand comes to the window, and it cuts back to Leo, and he's in the middle of the room walking towards Shelly. So where did that hand come from?
Right.
That's what I'm saying. The continuity stuff is a little weird. Here, this one. I got it. Oh, and the knife.
Yep.
The knife. She got to get the knife.
Shelly gets the knife.
Which takes her forever.
He's like, where's that knife?
I was yelling, like, why can't you get the knife?
Oh, no. Leo's got the axe on his throat of Bobby there.
Shelly can't find that knife.
He's like, goodbye, Bobby.
Leo is such a jerk.
It looks like he's going to be choked to death. And Shelley stabs him.
Right in the leg.
Right. And enough so that he...
He is like Frankenstein. He's like a classic horror monster. Right. He moves slow. He grunts. He barely speaks. And all logic escapes. There's no logic behind
him. But, I mean, he's been
him.
In a coma. I mean, who knows what his brain is like. I mean,
he has secret arms, and he can lock doors from both sides. Right. I don't know.
I love the wind and going through the plastic and that, yeah. just that feeling that he's yeah. out there, maybe. Yeah. But
I mean, all logic stuff. I'm picking right. on it a little too much. I mean, it was a cool scene.
I liked it.
Yeah, yeah. I liked it. But I'm just, you know what I'm right. saying? Like, I see these scenes, and I'm like, that was weird. Why was his arm there?
Right.
He's in the middle of the room.
He doesn't overthink. He's just supposed to just take it.
I know. I am overthinking.
If you can take Nadine and her super strength, you can handle
it. I know. Oh, no, I totally agree. I'm just, these are the things I noticed when I'm watching it. I just thought it was odd. Now, I think this is where we're going to go back to Cooper, and he's actually going to give us his backstory
right.
about how Wyndham Earle was his ex-partner, and the woman he was protecting was Wyndham Earle's wife.
Hmm.
Now, here's the thing. I'm getting the impression that Cooper was in love with her.
Hmm.
And there could have been an affair. I'm getting the impression that Wyndham Earle was mad or upset. And that he went crazy. They locked him up. He escaped. And now he's playing games with Cooper to get him back because the girl dies. The girl died under his watch.
Right.
He got knocked out. She was stabbed. Come to find out, he thinks Wyndham Earle is the one who killed her.
Yep.
And it was sort of like a message.
Yeah.
Like, you messed with the wrong guy. So I'm so mad at you, I'm going to kill my own wife.
Yeah, it's complicated.
If you
it's
can't really have her. Right. Nobody can, right?
Now, at the beginning of the second season, we found out that he had escaped, I think. It was kind of early on.
It was like an Easter egg. It was like in the background.
Right. It was something that, it was kind of like the seeds that planted.
Yeah.
And then if you can remember that Leland, when they finally caught him in jail there, Leland basically says to Cooper, oh, just like what happened to you in Pittsburgh.
Uh-huh.
And that's connected to
him. Okay, so that's what happened in Pittsburgh. Yeah.
So now we have Lucy and Andy's show there where he's flinging gloves.
Yes. I'm kind of happy. I mean, the whole, like, about Nikki. Okay, the Nikki stuff, I mean, oh, God, it's ridiculous. The whole, I'm glad they didn't go very far with it, with the whole Nikki thing. It wasn't much. It almost seemed like a throwaway. Like, we really need these characters to focus on something.
Right.
And let's give them the most petty thing. And they did. And it got resolved really quick.
Did it get resolved really quick?
Not yet, but it will. It will. It just seemed like here's where the show kind of falls apart for me is they have these good characters and they're using them. They're not using them wisely. Like they're not using them like at full capacity.
Right.
It's like they've just become like side plot
characters characters of
themselves.
Yeah. And I will say, so in that scene there, Andy basically says that little Nikki is a murderer. So he's like, oh, we've done some investigating and we've determined that I think he was age 6 when he did his first murder.
He killed his parents. Now here we go. Here is an officer of the law already pinning down a kid with no evidence that he's a murderer.
Right.
I don't know if he should be a police officer.
Well, this is the same. Andy's the same guy who would cry at everything.
I know. Can you imagine?
And he couldn't, for the longest time, he couldn't handle his gun.
Can you imagine all the crooks he put away? They would be like, I never did that. He doesn't know what he's talking about.
So we finally meet.
Her husband. James's.
Evelyn's husband.
Evelyn's husband.
I think it's Jeffrey is his name there.
And what a goon. He looks. I like how he's wearing a Nike Air Jordan like windbreaker. He clearly doesn't look like he's playing basketball anytime soon. He's does not fit. You can tell she married him for the money.
Yep.
And I think that's what they wanted to tell you by having him look like
this. Yeah, Jeffrey Marsh, he was kind of like into his own little thing and he just Want to bring some audio up just to
sure.
get a sense
oh,
of
yeah.
him?
Overdue as it is.
Of course he'll stay. There are plenty of things I could find for him to do. Right, James?
Of course, now he's not talking, but...
Yeah, maybe. Excuse me.
It's like, this is very awkward because I'm a
nice kid.
He's done a fine job on the car.
Fine car on
the car.
Goodbye, Jeffrey.
Oh, and okay, so this is interesting. He drives away and they do a close up of her face, but hold on, I gotta bring it up. Listen to this. They didn't have the scream in there.
I don't remember there being a scream.
Oh my god, I remember hearing the scream.
Maybe
it's
on your Blu-ray edition. They added in a scream or something. I don't remember.
It was a George Lucas scream, or maybe I'm thinking of something else.
No, but what we heard was that she's looking in the distance, and then we hear the skidding of tires to make believe that it seemed like the car has got into a crash. But it's kind of like the same thinking that James is in his room and he can hear Evelyn and Jeffrey Marsh fighting 300 feet away.
That's where the logic of the show gets crazy.
I mean, it's hard to say. How do you tell a story where how do you basically let them know that an accident happened without showing it and just moving the story
along? Well, a crazier thing is that he got an accident the moment he drove out of the parking lot.
Right.
Like, he literally just drove out.
I don't think he did. I mean, I think it could have happened 10 minutes from now, but I think it was a quick way to tell the story.
Yeah,
Actually, in the script, I think they had some other kind of sequence. Like, I forgot what they were going to do, but in the actual script, it was something where James was there and he was thinking and they showed, like, close up of a tire or something. They did some other kind of.
Okay.
But it's still, it's hard to tell a story without. I mean, they don't have a budget to.
I know.
The car skids, it rolls over. Over, blows up. I mean, they don't have that kind of a budget.
Oh, no, I totally agree. And, like, it does, it gets the point across that she, but here's, okay, here's what I'm trying to figure out. Why would the car crash? James fixed it, but did she tell James to fix it in a way that was going to make him crash? I don't get that. But here's what I think. James fixed the car, and then her brother/boyfriend...
Malcolm
tweaked it so he would like lose his brakes or something.
I think
so
that's a good theory.
They can pin it on James.
Right. I think that sounds like a good theory.
Yeah. Because I'm like, and then, you know, but here's the other thing. If he dies, only she knows about James. He's dead. He can't be like, that boy was fixing my car. So then she's going to have to, and the other guy are going to have to blame James. But, like, if that's what she wants to do, I don't know, it seems a little flawed.
I think there's more to come, right? Wait, I think, there's definitely more to come to find out. And so we're at the double R, and Ed is talking to the doctor, Hayward there.
Yeah.
And I think they're talking about the concern about Nadine's sexual activity.
I know. And I like how he says, well, I feel like I've been run over by a truck overnight. And I'm like, what? I don't think is he implying they're still having sex?
Yep.
But that's wrong because he likes Norma and Nadine likes Mike. So
it's a true soap opera. You know, everybody is with everybody and stuff.
I'm assuming they weren't. And she acts like a kid.
Right.
So I thought he was turned off by her.
Not enough.
Feels like I'm hit by a truck.
So, yeah, so there's that storyline going on. And it's kind of funny that he should even care, right? Because he is with Norma.
And he says it's like being a parent, right?
It's like,
weird.
It's really disturbing.
It's disturbing.
We've talked about incest and we've talked about this other stuff. But it's like, if you really think would we think she's supposed to be 16, 17, 18 or something? And he's like, I'm her guardian, but I'm also I'm also with her. I'm also having sex with her.
Yeah.
And stuff, but,
Maybe we're reading into that line too much.
No, we're not.
No, I'm thinking she comes in, punches him in the face, and goes to sleep.
I felt, yeah.
That's how I took it.
Now, this show definitely has its innuendos, and I definitely think that's what it's saying, that he's definitely with her and stuff. So, but you know, Ed and Norma are getting cozy. They seem like they're friendly with each other.
I like their little storyline.
Yeah.
It's sweet, and I think they belong together. And I'm kind of rooting for them two crazy kids to be together. I don't like Hank. Hank. I don't like her husband, Hank.
Yeah.
And Nadine's crazy. And I think they're probably the most normal people on the show right now.
Right.
Right now.
Yeah.
I think you know.
I forgot to mention a couple scenes before where Cooper was talking with Truman, and Cooper hasn't been reinstated yet as an FBI agent, but he does mention Dennis, and that's the end of that. We won't see.
Oh, Dave Duchovny's gone?
He's gone. He's gone from the rest of the show. So that was it. I know. It was like we didn't get an official goodbye. We didn't get handshake, hugs, or anything like that.
Wow.
It's kind of like they wrapped up that case, and that's the end of Denise.
That's a shame.
Yeah. There's still hope. Maybe season three he can come back. And I think we've shared before. I know that David Duchovny would be all for it and stuff. And
maybe when we get the interview, he'll slip.
Right. Maybe.
Tell us.
That sounds good. So we're back with James and Evelyn, and James is like, I'm out of here. I'm done with this place. I can't handle making out with
him. I'm moody. I'm moody James. Yeah, he...
It's wrong. You want to bring up the audio?
Oh,
this is so
God.
Funny.
It's so bad.
Love isn't wrong, James.
He's listening to a game.
Please don't leave me. Don't leave me alone with him.
What a shot.
He's just thinking.
Go check my bike.
He does a lot of bad thinking a lot.
Yeah.
Like, I that shot should have been followed by a shot of a hamster running on a wheel to indicate him.
And we missed the thing. It's like, it's wrong. It's wrong. It's like, what do you know about being wrong? Like, he was dating Laura Palmer. He was Laura Palmer was dating Bobby. So he's already was kind of cheating with, and then he gets in with Donna, which I guess isn't really cheating because Laura's dead, but he seems like he has no problem. Oh, and then Madeline, he's with Madeline while he was with Donna.
But I think it's because she's married, and I think he's getting, like, they haven't announced her husband being dead yet. No.
Well, no, but no. We do know. We just heard about the accident, so I think we're probably
close. So I feel like he feels something's up. So maybe he thinks it's wrong that she's married.
And I totally understand that. Like,
it's different. Like, I feel like they're a bunch of teenagers. That's what they do.
Yeah.
But she's married, and then something's wrong. Like, I feel like the hamster in his head's telling him something's
right.
Up.
I mean, to be in front of him and say, "Oh yeah, I'm helping with your car," and which car really means, I'm making out with your wife. I'm having sex with your wife.
Yeah.
I think we talked about the last episode that car is definitely representing her.
Yes.
That, like, I'm gonna fix your
car. Yeah. Like, so, and it was awkward that she would say all those things in front of her husband, in front of him. And
I mean, I don't know if she gets off on that or what, but
yeah.
So we're back back in the sheriff's station, and Cooper's still looking at the board and, like,
the chessboard,
right? Trying to figure out what to do next here. And I think that, I mean, and this is where we were mentioning it before, where I think Harry Truman's going to say, you know, now that Cooper is deputized and he actually works for Harry, Harry's like, you know, I need more information now on this. It's like, now that you work for me, you can't be keeping secrets. You got to basically tell us.
So this is where it comes out.
Yeah, it comes out. Yeah.
And I kind of like this. This is the stuff I dig on this part of the show. I mean, I feel this episode, the James stuff gets good. It's still weird, but it still gets good, and I love this stuff, you know.
You want to bring up some audio?
Sure.
Harry, I've brought some baggage to town I haven't told you about. Wyndham Earle was my first partner. Everything I know about the law and the bureau I owe to him. 4 years ago, we drew the assignment of protecting a material witness in a federal crime. She was a very beautiful, very gentle woman. Her name was Carolyn. She and I fell in love. One night, I failed in my vigilance. Attack was made. I wasn't ready. I was wounded and I lost consciousness. When I came to, she was in my arms. She was dead. She'd been stabbed.
The wounds on the vagrant.
Identical. The killer was never found. My wound healed. Wyndham Earle went mad. institutionalized until his recent escape.
So why is he after you?
Harry, Caroline was Wyndham Earle's wife.
Dun, dun, dun.
So he blames you for her death.
It's much worse than that. I think he killed her. And I think he committed the crime that she originally witnessed. Harry, Wyndham Earle's mind is like a diamond. It's cold and hard and brilliant. I think he feigned the insanity that sent him away. But at some point, he lost the ability to distinguish between what's right and what's wrong. You don't know what he's capable of, Harry.
And I love the diamond, his mind's like a diamond quote.
Yeah.
I like that.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think we were talking about how Jean Renault, you know, we got rid of that character, but it was like, okay, we got another character. We got another villain coming in. We got Wyndham Earle finally showing up and stuff. And so I think this is the big villain now we've got. And I mean, that's a lot of backstory to dump on us.
You know, it is not, this is very un Twin Peaks like. Because if David Lynch and the original guy, you know, Mark Frost were doing this, I kind of feel like for Twin Peaks, these last two episodes, to dump so much information onto us and give it to us straightforward, where Twin Peaks was never about being straightforward. It was about, like, figuring it out.
Yeah.
And sometimes you wouldn't know exactly, but it's weird to have a character just tell you. I mean, in Cooper's case, it makes sense.
Right.
But
I
feel like it would have been more like a puzzle.
Right, they have been sprinkling it here and there. There was another scene way back with Cooper and Audrey, and Cooper says to Audrey how he hurt somebody before. He was trying to basically say why I can't be with you, Audrey.
Yeah.
Because, you were on a case
You're
of
right.
mine.
Those puzzle pieces there.
They were there. And now you get to this point, it's like, oh, yeah, I remember when he talked to Audrey and said, I can't. You know, we can't be together because you were on a case and somebody got hurt by me.
Yeah.
And now you're
saying,
oh, yeah. And there was another, and then there's the whole shooting gallery with Andy, and he's saying that he talks about this love interest and stuff too.
Yeah.
About how,
you're right. Yeah. So, I didn't think about that.
It's
you're
been
right.
there, but in some ways it was spread out so much that we it takes
you
a while to forget that.
It.
Like, oh, yeah, I guess he did talk about this here and there. And so, yeah. So now Donna has gone to bring, was it $12 to James?
This is where it gets weird. I think this is where it goes
she's
downhill.
She's in a new town. She's left Twin Peaks to find James and bring him his $12.
And she goes to Willie's hideout or hangout or whatever the name of his bar is.
Right.
And which looks exactly like the bar that happened in season...
Roadhouse?
The Roadhouse. Yeah. It looks like the Roadhouse a little bit.
I'm sure that's all they have for a set. But
yeah, well, it is because they visit this place a lot. And she happens to meet
Evelyn,
right. who hangs out there constantly.
She's got her lollipop sucking on her lollipop.
And there's nobody else in this place. It's always Evelyn.
Right.
That's it. She's
well, I mean, she's got the money, too. So, I mean, I'm sure that keeps the place running there.
Right? Yeah. She goes there. She drinks all day.
Right.
Gets suckers. Try to kill her husband.
I love that Donna has her cigarette. She's like, I'm tough, too. You know, you're not the only tough one. And so,
Oh, her acting is a little weird. I just
did
bring
some
it.
Work for me recently.
Oh, yeah, see, she whispers. I like this.
He fixed my husband's car. Where is he? He left. Yesterday. On his bike. Where'd he go?
Where'd he go? It's like she's whispering.
Something about the ocean. Mexico, I think.
You know, the ocean in Mexico.
Yeah. That's all. Like, she's like, it's almost like she's trying to mimic her to be as, like, I'm a woman too. Like, it's coming across like, like, I'm going to be tough.
Right.
Like, it's weird.
Well, I mean, I think this whole storyline is kind of a film noir, and I think that's supposed to be like old school kind of like, you know.
Yeah.
That's old
She's
style.
She's doing detective work.
Yeah.
Like, where'd you go?
Hey, yeah.
Yeah. Like, I'm going to find. I'm going to. And it just.
I'll bring up the auto. We got to love this.
Oh. Yeah, they bring back this music.
Right.
Oh, they do the emo. James is all sad and moody.
Yep.
He doesn't know what to do with himself. Yeah, I love that music.
Oh, yeah. But I mean, like, so I mean, I think they use that music to basically say that, oh, Don and James should be together, but they just can't because of the issues they're dealing with. Oh, and we're now back with
Civil War.
Civil War with Ben Horn.
He's on the wrong side. Why do they. Okay, here, indulge me. Why do you think they pick he's on the south and not the north?
I'm not sure.
Because they're located in the north.
Yeah. It's funny, too, because I think of it like. I don't know how things were in the 90s, but I look at this stuff now and, like, you know, in the last year, the Southern flag has been, like...
The really, Confederate flag, yeah.
Very controversial, and it shouldn't be, you know, even hung up in the States, and for a good reason and stuff.
But it's still
interesting to see this stuff now and be like, Ben Horn is on the South
side. Yeah, I was wondering if anybody can indulge us with that, because I was wondering.
And the funny thing, I mean, we're at the Pacific Northwest. It's not even, like, we're not anywhere close to the South.
That's where I'm trying to get from. Right. Like, why does he pick that side?
Maybe he picks that side because...
They lost and he feels like a loser?
Yes. I think
that's... You think that's it?
I think that's absolutely... I think, like... Yeah, I mean, I think to be in such big defeat, I mean, I think he can relate to...
Being a loser.
Being defeated. Yeah.
But I was almost thinking he would want to be on the winning side because he wants to feel empowered again.
Yeah.
I don't know. But I think, do you think it's like odd writing?
I can tell you when I'm depressed. I don't listen to happy music, and I don't listen to like I usually go into a place.
That's a good
where,
point.
That's where I usually do like stuff that is so depressing, and
makes you more depressed. Yes. Yeah. I hear you. I get you. So that makes sense. I didn't think about it.
And
that
Jerry
way.
Horn, his brother's back, and he's definitely seeing how disturbed he's in this place where he's now fully.
General Lee.
General Lee, he's fully in that place now.
And you have Jacoby, who's feeding it, and then his brother shows up, and he's going to start feeding it.
You want to bring
up
some Jacoby here?
Yeah.
He's on a forced march to Washington. You know, he's crossing the Maryland border as we speak. See, what he's doing is quite healthy. I mean, by reversing the South's defeat in the Civil War, he in turn will reverse his own emotional setbacks.
Well, there you go. Our question has been answered by Dr. Jacoby.
Men of the South, from this day to the ending of the earth.
He's got his little action figures, his little figures there. How long did it take him to set up this models and his trains? And
I know.
And I shared with you, I think, on the last show that the Civil War documentary by Ken Burns had just come out.
That could have been why they picked this whole scenario.
Yeah, that's why they did. It was something that like the nation was really into right now, and the writers liked it, and so they said, hey, why don't we make a story about that? I'll bring it back up the audio.
Oh, the fan.
To Washington! Oh, I wish I was in the land of cotton. Old time there, I'm not forgotten.
You get the fan, the flag.
Look away, look away.
And they're not very good singers at all. It's
really so bad. Here's some backstory on this.
Is that a real song?
Yeah, Dixie.
That's a
real song.
I never heard it before.
It's an anthem. It's a real song.
All right.
But that's so that was not in the script, and the director didn't realize this at first, but realized that the actors who played Ben and Jacoby. Actually starred in West Side Story movie, that original movie. I think it was from the 60s. So we're talking 30 years before Twin Peaks. They were in West Side Story.
So they were like, sing.
Yeah, I think they were brothers. Are they brothers in that? It was a long time ago. They sang in it. So they, this is a perfect opportunity. Why don't we have a little singing? It was all right. It's a nod. It's a nod to the two of these actors who have sung before.
That's cool.
So the next thing we have is Major Briggs stumbling into the sheriff's station.
Yeah, he's stumbling. And
I don't know. I mean, I guess he's been interrogated I think he's Air Force.
So bad that he collapsed cartoonishly onto the floor. Yes. And that's it.
And we have Lucy then saying, what's going on? Oh, I got to check my makeup.
Yeah.
So in a second, I probably want, definitely he's got some great dialogue.
Yes.
But I'll give him a second there. So... Major Briggs, we learned a little bit about the White Lodge, and he's about to reveal more about that. Well, yeah, that's good.
Well, as men who have dedicated their lives to service, I know that you're able to understand how sacred I hold the Pledge of Allegiance and the cost one must pay when breaking a pledge.
It can be very great.
Well, the Air Force, I thought, was not unlike other societies of men dedicated to the fight for the good. Gentlemen, frankly, I'm worried. When my superiors questioned me about my disappearance, they exhibited a degree of suspicion and intolerance bordering on the paranoid. I must now admit that their motivation in the search for the White Lodge is not ideologically pure. I believe that during my disappearance, I was taken to the White Lodge. I can remember virtually nothing. But I have the clear, intuitive sense that there's much trouble ahead.
Major, what kind of trouble?
I'm unaware of the form it will take. But I will return. Until that time, I will be in the shadows if you need.
I like that. I'll be in the shadows.
I like that too. I'll be in the shadows. I mean, I've got your back. I'm kind of there if you need me. But
the Men in Black are going to come for him.
Yeah.
Or something. You know, I get that impression that people might try to erase his memory or
make
it so he can't remember the White Lodge. Or.
And so you brought it up as like, is this White Lodge a physical place or not? Or is it some psychological thing? And from this scene, it seems like it could be a real place.
It could be. But it almost like, could it be a place, it's like this, it's a spiritual place, not maybe spiritual, or a place they can go that could be used in a way that could harm others, or they can get in people's minds. It's sort of like, I don't know why I just thought about this, but remember when the military, they tried to train, they were trying to make goats, use goats to like, be weapons
like goat sticks. I'm gonna say, you know where I'm going. Simulator. Video game. No.
But
I know what you're saying.
They're trying to use the goats to mine. They're trying to like. This guy said he can make like goats. Like, there's a whole study with goats. Like, it was it true?
But what you're saying is it seems like what Major Briggs is saying is that
it's like a form
the intentions of why they're looking for this
thing.
Place,
yeah.
Whether it be on a different plane or whatever, however you want to say it, may not be in good intentions. Maybe the military wants to use it for their own,
For bad.
For bad, or for not for the right reasons and stuff. You're going to look up right now, Brian is looking up.
No, I have to. Military.
Oh man, I don't know if our audience cares about goats.
The only reason
while Brian is looking up about goats, we move on to Lena, and Dr. Jacoby has diagnosed her that she seems like she's fine. She's not cursed or a witch, and she just has this this attraction that men can't resist.
Oh, God. Everybody, like, they're just, like, in love with her. They're infatuated by her. She's very attractive. She has an accent and the red hair, and everybody loves her. I mean, it's interesting. This is another little side plot that kind of goes – it doesn't really go anywhere.
Right.
It resolves on its own.
Yeah.
You know? And actually, I think it resolves in the scene. I think they're going to take her – it's very humorous the way it's done. They're going to take her. Jacoby, he seems to be smitten with her. Like,
and he's a married man. We've only seen his wife in one episode from Hawaii.
I think, his wife is a ruse. I think he gets smitten with every, like, Laura.
Yeah, he's He definitely was in love with Laura, too. You're right.
Yeah, so he's going to take her out, and then the mayor shows up with the shotgun.
Shotgun, right.
And he's like, I'm going to shoot her.
She killed my brother. Right.
And I love Cooper's whole thing. You guys go in there and talk.
Right. And the funny thing is they don't take away his shotgun, though. They say, you know, you can go in the room and, you know, work it out with your shotgun.
Yes. And then it's very comical because they all stand out there and someone says, how long do we have to wait? And then they cut the commercial break.
Right.
They come out of commercial break, and they're still waiting.
I love that.
That was great.
And the original script wasn't done that way. The original script had it so they worked it all out before the commercial break. But I think it's fitting in a way. I mean, this day and age, we stream it. We watch it on Blu-ray, DVD, and stuff.
There's no commercials.
But I remember watching it on TV, and, coming right back. And the idea is, how long do we have to wait? Well, we had to wait through the whole commercial. Something like that. I liked it. I thought it was funny.
Yeah, I thought it was funny, too. I really liked it. And then, we can gloss over this. I mean, basically, they open the door and she's like kissing the mayor, and he's just like, I have a change of heart. Come on, dear. And
now,
she has a thing for old guys.
Into me, yeah.
Yeah, I don't get it. Like,
she likes everybody though. I mean,
but she really goes after him.
Well, the thing is, right before she, you know, when she was leaving, before we found out the mayor was there waiting for them at the door, she was going to go with Jacoby. Like, they were going to go bowling.
I know.
So clearly, like, she's with Jacoby. He's like, let's go bowling. Oh, the mayor's here. I decided I'm just going to go with the mayor instead. But it's like, I'm sure if she walked outside and somebody came by and said, you want to fly a kite? She's like, I'm going to go fly a kite.
Yeah, yeah. And all the guys have this big smile on their face.
Oh.
So is that the last we see of her?
No way.
We see her again?
Yep.
Oh God, I'm interested to see where this goes.
I should have said something about this. We should go. I'm gonna bring up some audio for a minute.
I don't know about you guys, but I could definitely use something to drink.
Me too.
And they're like, oh yeah, me too.
I swear. So that the way they're all acting, and then the thing you see is a totem pole, and the way the angle is, to me that looks very much like a phallic symbol.
Ben,
I'm just saying,
you're really making this perverted.
It is. The show is perverted. I try to avoid the perversion.
So do you
think, show is Twin Peaks, and the thing is, even Mark Frost has kind of said sometimes that Twin Peaks could mean breast and stuff like that. I'm just saying.
Wait, so do you think that all these guys had erections, and they all went to the bar together? What are you implying?
I don't know. I think there's more audio here that something else comes up. Now listen to this here. No, leave this up. Here, bring up the audio. So we see this phallic symbol of the totem. Yep. And then we hear Pete Martell.
Hot dogs.
Forgot the hot dogs.
Pete.
One more time.
We forgot the weenies.
Oh, yeah.
The weenies. Why didn't we bring up weenies right after we saw this phallic symbol and everything? I'm just saying.
All right.
This show, I mean, over and over again, I think every episode we could probably see phallic symbols. And maybe it's just me. But
see, I just picture these guys all going to the bar going, well, we just got to cool off a little bit. And I love how he says weenies. We forgot the weenies.
Yes. Josie was supposed to, she went grocery shopping and they forgot the weenies.
Oh, that Josie.
Yes.
It should be a sitcom, an ABC. Oh, that Josie.
Oh, that Josie. So now Catherine Martell is talking to her husband, Pete. And she's saying, hey, how do you think I was able to survive and beat Ben Horn? And we find out, well, we already knew this, but Pete finds out that Andrew Packard is alive.
Which we did see him once before, a long time ago.
We've seen him. Or I think we saw him one of these episodes that we realized he was alive and stuff.
And this is where they start introducing more characters, too. So I kind of feel like they're wrapping up these side plots to give more give us more of these characters.
I do feel like the Josie storyline is always seems to be the most convoluted. I always feel
always.
Like it's like, okay.
So this is the guy that should have been dead in the boat accident.
Right.
So that Hank supposedly killed.
Exactly. So yeah. I mean, like, we definitely need a flow
chart. He's kind of old. Cuz he was married to Josie?
Yes.
What's up with that?
I know.
What's with these very attractive women with these very old men? This show is very weird.
And I think, I think it's clear that
the writers have some issues.
No, not at all. Not at all. Scott Frost is great.
Yeah.
No, but it seems, I forgot what I was going to say now, but yeah.
They're fantasies.
What I was going to say is by now it's clear that Josie has her own intentions.
Yeah.
Andrew has his own intentions. Everybody has their own intentions on what
Always.
They're doing
yes.
and stuff like that. So I don't think Josie married Andrew for love.
It was for money, as
something,
they all
yeah,
do.
Right.
So it wasn't for his looks.
And then we learn about,
oh God, this guy or
yes.
whatever it is. Oh, this girl.
Jones, we see, but it's
Eckhart.
So that is like Andrew's rival, like their enemies and stuff. And
yes.
so there be Eckhart is checking into the Great Northern. I do like this whole effect with the sunglasses and the fire in his eyes. Like he's like, oh, is this guy evil?
Yeah. No, it was really cool. And this is like our evil guy.
Yes, another evil
guy. It was definitely a cool scene. Very style. This episode had a lot of style. To it, definitely.
So, and then we're back at the Great Northern, the waterfalls.
Another phallic symbol. No, I'm just kidding. Another symbol for something. Oh, so this is the whole, you know,
Oh, right. So we learned more about little Nicky's history, and that his, I think his mother was a maid at the Great Northern, and she died, and he's had just a tragic. And then
wrapping it up, they're just saying little Nicky's not the devil. We don't need to do this anymore.
Maybe so. And Andy and Dick are crying.
Please don't tell. Yeah, I know. I love how they're crying. Please don't tell me they're going to bring up little Nicky again. All right, we're going to go to James.
James is leaving. He's done.
Which we thought he left already.
I do feel like every scene he has to say, I'm leaving. I'm leaving. He just has to remind everybody he's leaving.
He really likes her that much. He's like, I'm leaving, but I can't leave you.
And then, what is that Mango from Saturday Night Live? He's like, ah.
Yes. Maybe Mango was they took that character from James from this.
There you go.
Maybe that was their.
No. All right, you bring up the audio for a second.
I'm James. I'm Mango.
Oh, the police are coming.
Okay. The police become very.
They have this Twin Peaks theme music here.
There's been an accident.
How do you know there's been an accident? How did you know?
I know, right?
Jeffrey's dead.
His car.
Yes.
The hamster's running.
No.
He's figuring it all out.
My God, you set me up!
He figured that out pretty quick for James.
He's not my brother.
You were right, he's not his brother.
I know. His eyes get so big on that one. He's like, what? Now, here's the thing I don't get. It was not much audio. Yeah. So she's telling him to leave. Obviously, she cares about him a little bit. At some point.
Right.
And I like how Donna's hanging around this house and he runs into Donna and, you know, she's like, we got to get out of here. We got to get out of here. Well, how did she get here? Did she take a car, a bus?
Taxi? Like, I don't know.
Now, you'd think they would go away, but they don't. They don't go away.
They do have a habit of doing the wrong thing
all the time.
I mean,
we'll get into that later.
Oh, so we're now in the woods, and we're looking up at the trees, and it's Leo. He's in the woods.
Yeah.
So that's after running away from Shelley after he got stabbed.
So he's basically.
And there's an owl flies by.
See, that's what I'm saying. Heavy-handed. We got owls.
We were talking off the air. I think about how it seems like a lot of owls.
Yes,
around,
I feel like there's a lot of.
I like it. I mean, I want more. I want to tell me more about the origins of the owls and the spirits and stuff. But I do know that we definitely have a lot of nods to owls.
Yeah, a lot of nods. A lot more. Now, the flute playing, which is, he finds this cabin. Now, is this cabin a lodge of some sort?
It's a cabin.
It's just a cabin?
I mean, just like how Jacques had a cabin.
Is it the cabin from Lost?
That's awesome, yeah.
It could be a nod.
It could be.
Lost could have nodded the cabin.
It's not the Logley's cabin. It's not Jacques' cabin. It's just another cabin in the woods. Bar of soap, bad girl.
And Leo still can't speak correctly.
Somebody's calling us. Should we take a caller?
I think that's our caller one. You're on the air. We're taking questions.
What do you want to say about
Twin Peaks?
Twin Peaks. Wyndham Earl.
So, we get to see Wyndham Earl.
Yeah, this is our first appearance of Wyndham Earl. We've had little notes and dead bodies, and now we get to see him.
He's not what I expected.
What did you expect?
Someone that looks more like Cooper.
Ah, he's wearing a suit?
Sort of.
Sort of.
But he just looks like, I don't know what I was expecting.
That's interesting.
I was not expecting him.
Wyndham. What do you make of him right now? I mean, you don't get much from him right now. You just see that he's a smiley.
I mean, he comes off as a creeper
and a
bad guy. And this is our third bad guy in one episode.
Yeah,
we're setting up three bad guys.
For a while, it seems like we didn't have any bad guys.
Now we have three.
Yep.
Like I almost feel like this is like a Marvel movie. This is like we got three bad guys, and the Avengers got to come in and take care of business. No, this episode was definitely a lot of fun. You know, all kidding aside, I thought it was fun. I enjoyed it. Yeah.
And clearly, I think the big thing is Cooper's origins, that we get a little more sense that he wasn't perfect. He unfortunately wasn't able to save the woman that he loved.
Yes.
Then to find out that she was married to Wyndham Earl, and we get a little more sense of Wyndham Earl might have been involved of this case.
Yeah. That's why, you know why I thought Wyndham Earl looked weird? When they gave us the brief look of her.
Yeah.
Yet again, very.
You think she's too good for him?
Yes. Attractive woman, and they get Wyndham Earl, and he looks like a putz. Just like, like this whole running theme of this half of the show.
Yeah.
Maybe she was marrying Wyndham Earl for
the money.
I think
he said it was 4 years ago that they had this case, so maybe he was really attractive 4 years ago.
And now he let himself go. He's turned into
creep. Muscular. He's really in shape, and then he's kind of like, I don't have a wife anymore.
What do I care? I'm a killer. I'm a serial killer. I'm crazy. It was
exciting to finally see him, though. Actually, you know, we've been hinting at him for, it seems like, at least 10 episodes.
Yeah. We get to see him, and I'm interested to see how it all goes out with the season. I mean, it's fun, though. It's cheesy fun, like you say. This stuff, you kind of have to just go with it. You okay, Ben?
Yeah, I keep thinking.
You just might want to pause that.
I will.
Oh, yeah. Okay. But I kind of feel like you have to just let it go, because if you think too hard about this stuff, it does drive you crazy. Like, the whole scene with his hand was, like, weird. The logic for these episodes seem kind of out of place. Some stuff seems kind of wonky to me.
Yeah.
Which, you know, if I wasn't doing the show with you, I wouldn't overthink it.
True.
Because I'm watching this with more of a careful eye. I see these funny things. And I'm sure a lot of fans saw this and said, because it's not the way Twin Peaks was.
Right.
You're comparing it to the way it was, and this is the way it is now, and, you know, it's still enjoyable.
And I still love the mythology. I love that we're getting little hints of this White Lodge and that Major Briggs is involved with it, and I want more. It's like, okay, you know, where is this going? Like, you know.
And I think I enjoyed this more because we got more of that and less of the Andy, Little Nicky stuff. We didn't get much of it. And it wrapped up, the way I see it so far, it wrapped up. I don't care about Little Nicky. James's thing seems to be wrapping up. It was interesting with this episode.
Yeah.
With Donna showing up.
Right.
With his $12.
Yeah.
But that might be the cab fare to get him back to Twin Peaks. Did she spend the $12 to get herself there?
Yeah.
I don't know.
And we're never going to let that go. Like I said in the last week there, or the last show we did, that it was Big Ed that said $12. It was never even in the script. So I don't know if the director says, just give some kind of money to mention. But I still think it's $12.
$12.
Yeah.
Well, back then, that was a lot of money.
Yeah, 1990, you know. You could have bought, it's a lot of money.
You could have filled up your car for six.
But yeah, like I said, the White Lodge is exciting to find out more. And it makes me think of X-Files in the sense that, like, oh, we've got military people and the search for the truth. And, you know, can Major Briggs trust his employers? And are they truthful with him?
Yeah. And he maybe, it almost feels like he wants to protect it. Like, he's a protector.
Right.
Like, he's like, these people, if they get their hands on whatever this is,
they're
going to use it probably for bad, not for good. And I feel like the White Lodge could be a place that he wants to keep under wraps.
Yeah, sacred, that it's not abused and misused.
Yeah,
And that maybe Cooper and Truman are the only people he feels like he can really trust. And, like, because he does keep on sprinkling a little bit of things he probably shouldn't. It's like, okay, I probably shouldn't share this with you, but I'm going to tell you because, it's important.
Yeah. And I think, after the whole Leland thing, I think he can trust them because they all have a bond now.
Right.
They were all part of that.
Right.
You know?
They kind of understand. Yeah, they have a better understanding of the woods, of this town, of the secrets and stuff. But,
so I feel like he feels comfortable telling them, and they would help him. So I like that. It's cool. I like that stuff, too.
Yeah.
So
another great episode.
Yeah.
It's good stuff.
It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
I like it.
I enjoy. I mean, I'm really happy with the direction it's going. I think it's going in the right direction to actually put a face to Cooper's villain and see where Leo's woken up and what's going to happen.
He's still a meathead. He can't speak. He's like Frankenstein.
Right.
Yeah. He's. I'm interested to see what's going to happen next week. So
cool.
A lot of fun.
Well, I think it's a good episode. I think we probably should wrap it up.
Yeah, we should wrap it up.
Twin Peaks Unwrapped.
And we're going to wrap it back up. And you can check us out on Facebook, Twin Peaks Unwrapped. Like us. We're getting a lot more likes. I think we've gotten a few more over the week. our Michael Horse episode. If you haven't listened to it yet, it's not going to spoil anything. I highly recommend it.
He's lying when he says it's not going to spoil anything. No. There are some small spoilers.
It is. I think for season three.
For season three, he mentioned some cast people that might be in it.
And, you know, when we did the interview, it didn't really dawn on us what he said. We were so in the moment.
Yeah.
And it blew up.
Right.
Which is really cool. I thank everybody for spreading, sharing it.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. It was really awesome. I mean, it was a great show. And I think it's funny. Somebody commented how we actually were quiet at times where he did share things. Because I went in saying that I didn't think he was going to talk at all about the new season. I think the only thing we were hoping to get out of him was talk a little bit more about the trailer that he did, where he spoke about
and he did.
He brought that up. But then on his own, he shared with us a little bit about the new season.
Yeah.
And that was really cool.
It was cool.
Yeah.
And you know, we were quiet because it's an over-the-phone interview.
Yeah.
You don't know the nuances of an interview face-to-face or lost. You don't know what to speak. And when he did say that stuff, our faces were like, wow.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you know, after the interview was over, it was just so much to ingest that I think I was just kind of like, wow, that was so cool he said that stuff. But we didn't really think it would spark the interest that it did. Like, I didn't know.
Right. And I think you remember, Brian, I said like, oh, this was terrible. Like, I didn't do a good interview, and I don't think we got as much. And I mean, I was happy we got things like the cowboy and the Frenchman, because those are things we don't hear about as much.
Yeah.
But it's like, oh, are people not going to be happy we didn't get anything about Twin Peaks, really? And then to re-listen, it's like, oh, wait a minute. He talked plenty about it. Like, he talked about, you know, David Duchovny's sister.
I love that story.
I love that story.
It's because we were in the moment.
We're in the moment.
When you're in the moment, it's so different. So we thank everybody in the community for, like, embracing that episode, sharing it with everybody.
Totally. That was awesome.
And for new listeners, I hope you join us for the rest of our show.
And that was our most popular show we've ever done. And
yes.
To me, that's awesome. I mean, that's
really
exciting.
Awesome.
It's exciting to, you know, we just do this as a hobby for fun. And
I know.
Stuff, and just to, you know, see that people are interested. And that's why it's sometimes so important if you guys would just go to iTunes and, like, rate us and do a review.
Subscribe to us.
And, but just to see that people are interested in it, it makes us want to keep doing it. It makes us want to keep on trying to get interviews with people because we know that people are having fun and enjoying this.
Yeah, and it's a lot of, you know, we put a lot of hard work into it, and, you know, I think people appreciate that. I think it shows. And if you have comments or questions, you can email us
at twinpeaksunwrapped@gmail.com.
Exactly. And we haven't gotten anything new, but if we do, we'll read it on the air.
I think, is it Christian? I mean, I keep meaning to bring Christian stuff up, but that he does write to us, and we'll have to get him on one time.
All right, cool.
But yeah, and then we also have the Twin Peaks Unwrapped paper that comes out on Mondays and Thursdays.
Yes.
And that's really a community paper. So it's really stories that you guys have shared on Twitter and on Facebook, on YouTube, and stuff like that. So that's a really fun thing. It's kind of, it's just fun to see what other people are sharing, and then to kind of give it back and share that. Yeah.
Yeah. And cool. Don't forget, we're on Twitter.
Yeah, Twitter, Twin Peaks Unwrapped.
Whoa, we're killing it on Twitter, Ben. You're doing a good job.
We're doing a great job. It's fun. It's great talking with people.
I think we get more communication on Twitter.
Right.
And it's a lot of fun. It is. I check it out. I know you do a lot more corresponding with people, but I'll check it out, and it's like, wow, the messages we get, the retweets we get, it's awesome.
It's really cool.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. So I think we will end with I thought we'd end with a Mark Frost interview.
Ooh.
And the interview was from 2011, and it was WFDU FM, the Modern Rock Show. And I really thought it was just kind of fun to see that time period in 2011 what Mark Frost was thinking about Twin Peaks and. Yeah, and kind of where we were, we had no clue that we were going to get a new season. And yeah, so I just thought it'd be fun. I thought maybe we'd do like 5 minutes of this interview, but it's really cool.
Cool.
Yeah, it's the Modern Rock Show 89.1, and it's hosted by Ghostly. So here's 5 minutes of that, and I can't wait till next week's show.
Excellent.
Thanks.
Of the TV series Twin Peaks, and Mark joins us on the phone. Mark, you know, last year was the 20th anniversary of Twin Peaks, and that seemed to have set off this huge resurgence in popularity for the show, with many young people discovering it for the first time. Is that overwhelming to you, that after all this time, the show still resonates?
Well, it's obviously really gratifying, because at the time, we were trying to make a show that would last. So much of television is like fast food, you know. It's high caloric intake and high in fats, and can be very satisfying, but it's not necessarily good for you in the long run. And you very often forget about it almost immediately afterwards. And I had this conviction that we should be trying to make the show to last, that we were trying to make it feel like you were watching a number of small feature films. With that kind of attention to detail and that kind of quality control. And, you know, I think that the key to it lasting was the life of the show being extended by DVD. And when we came out with the kind of definitive collection of the Twin Peaks experience in the Gold Box edition, which I think came out about 3 years ago.
Yeah.
That really, I think, brought it to a whole new generation's attention. It wasn't just something that you had to catch late one night on television or in syndication. You could actually hold it in your hands and control the experience again. And that seems to have kicked off this kind of renaissance that it's had.
Yeah, and I know a lot of people now, I think through Netflix or something along those lines, they can stream it on their computers.
Yeah, and that's relatively recent. I think that's within the last few months.
Yeah.
So it's even more accessible now.
And, you know, it's interesting because, as you mentioned, you know, there is a feature film quality to that program. And in a way, I guess it's the precursor to the things we saw later on, these series like The Sopranos on HBO, or maybe that was Showtime. But, you know, these prestigious programs that the shows would have a finite season of maybe 7 or 8 episodes. Do you think having that kind of a schedule might have prolonged Twin Peaks' life on television?
Yeah, I think there's probably no question about that. We were still working in the kind of antediluvian atmosphere of really three networks, or three and a half, because Fox was sort of a network at
right.
that point. And that was it. And they had this kind of stranglehold on entertainment. HBO hadn't started original programming yet. The DVR hadn't really come on the scene. People were still making jokes about how they never learned to operate their VCR. So that was kind of hit and miss as an experience. So we were just a little bit ahead of the wave. And my guess is that had we come along a little bit later, the show would probably have run quite a bit longer. The networks had much higher expectations of what a show should do and how it should perform. And I think if you were to look at what ABC is doing now with their nightly numbers, they would go back and kill to have a few more seasons of Twin Peaks under their belt.
And for some reason, I don't know exactly what happened, but I know ABC moved the time slot around.
Yeah, we got into trouble going into the second year. I mean, we had come on a Thursday night. The first season exceeded, just blew the doors off everybody's expectations.
Mm-hmm.
And they promptly rewarded us by moving us to Saturday, which was commonly thought of as a graveyard for network television even then. And then the other thing that happened is, as we got deeper into the season, the Gulf War began. And for, I think, something like 6 out of 8 weeks, we were preempted so that they could cut live to Baghdad and watch bombs fall live on television.
So, right.
It was the kind of show that didn't withstand a lack of continuity very well. It needed to be seen in rhythm and on a regular basis for the show as a continuing serial drama –